Forgotten Soldier by Sagers, Part 4, Chapter 11. On the train from Vinnytsia toward Lviv in Lublin, traveling with soldiers who'd been at Cherkasy and Kremenchuk, they told me about the hellish fighting which had taken place near those towns, now lost to us or sleeping from our grasp. Everywhere the crushing numerical superiority of the enemy was finally overwhelming our positions, which we defended with desperate determination, paying an appalling price in casualties. All the fellows on the train were going on leave too, but despite their joy, they seemed crushed by the experiences they had just lived through. The train came into Lublin station at dawn on a winter morning. The ground was covered with snow, and the Polish cold felt more sharper than the cold in Russia. Even though we were used to sleeping outdoors, no one had been able to rest on the train, and we greeted the morning with turned-up collars and gray faces. Despite the early hour, the station platforms were crowded with soldiers walking up and down to keep warm, dressed, and equipped for the front. There were many new recruits, easily distinguishable by their boyish, rosy faces. Military police had been stationed at intervals of 10 yards down the length of the platform for incoming trains. I had overestimated my strength. As I obeyed the orders barked over the PA system and jumped down onto the platform, I was shaking with sleeplessness and cold, and my legs were buckling under me. We lined up parallel to the train and marched into the big hall, which stood at one end of the station. As we tramped toward the hall, the gasping locomotive pulled the empty train onto a secondary track. In the hall, we were each given a cup of steaming ersatz and 2 spoonfuls of curious jam. As we ate, several officers climbed into a wheeled platform equipped with a loudspeaker. Military policemen were standing watchfully on either side of them and at the foot of the platform. First, the amplifier crackled and buzzed for a minute, and then a nasal voice roared unintelligibly until someone adjusted the mechanism. The principal thrust of the officer's speech struck all of us like a slap in the face. Leaves must be canceled. We thought we must have misunderstood him. But then the familiar series. Necessity. Difficulty. Duty. Supplementary effort. Victory. Brought it home to us that this was no dream. The crowd buzzed angrily, and a few fellows even shouted their outrage. But the loudspeakers were already blaring the Deutschmarsch, drowning our fury in martial music. As the hopes and plans of 7,000 men crumbled, the music grew louder. The jam we were swallowing suddenly seemed tasteless, and the ersatz bitter. Before we had time to feel sorry for ourselves, the MPs were herding us toward a train which was ready to leave for the east. 3 cars were loaded with supplies for the troops, and we were ordered to line up beside them. Because our nervous exhaustion and disappointment were so evident, and the desire to desert so clearly stamped on so many faces, we were closely hemmed in by the police. We were issued fur hats, like the hats worn by the Russian troops, crudely made over vests of reverse sheepskin, cotton gloves with woolen linings, and enormous overshoes with reinforced cork soles and felt uppers. A few boxes of tinned foods were added to this voluminous issue, and we no longer entertained any doubts as to our fate. We were obviously being shipped back for another winter in Russia. Most of us were ready to cry with disappointment. The train was crammed to the bursting point. Some of the passengers were young boys about to go into combat for the first time. Others were veterans returning from leave who were scarcely any happier than we were. And others, like myself, had been suddenly obliged to replace their plans for leave with the sinking apprehension which all men, no matter how brave, feel as they are about to confront a highly problematical fate. We rolled east for a considerable time before we finally grasped what had happened to us. I was dumb with disappointment, remembering Magdeburg in my despair when the scope of that leave was abruptly limited. This time, Berlin wasn't even on my route, and there was no chance of encountering Paola. There had been no period of grace at all, not even 24 hours. As I thought about it, the weight of what had just occurred seemed to increase, dragging me down into black depression. However, I still had one hope. As soon as I had returned to my unit, I would have my status as a convalescent officially verified. Why hadn't I thought of explaining that to the police at the station? But of course, no one in his right mind should ever expect anything decent from a military policeman. My last chance was that once I got back to the company, the Weißreiter would be able to arrange things for me. As always, the trains for the front were moving at top speed, unlike westbound trains, which often made long, inexplicable stops. Ours was no exception to this rule. Nevertheless, an important incident broke our momentum. The locomotive had just refueled and resumed the speed, which was to carry us through to Vinnytsia. The station we had stopped had bristled with signs bearing the names of towns no longer accessible to us. Konotop, Kursk, Kharkov, names which evoked unbearably painful memories. About 15 minutes out of the station, the train braked so violently that all of the carriages shuddered and we nearly left the rails. Inside, men and boxes were flung all over to the floor, and the air rang with angry curses. We all thought we had in fact been derailed. Soldiers in long coats were running down the length of the tracks, answering our shouted questions by waving ahead. "You were lucky we could stop you," one of them yelled. About 500 yards to the east, the track, which ran between two walls of sparse woodland, was blocked by a chaos of overturned cars. We jumped down to the track to find out what had happened. Partisans. Dynamite on the track. Train loaded with munitions. 150 soldiers killed. Reprisals. Patrols. Pursuit. The immediate work had already been divided among 300 unhurt soldiers. One group remained on the spot to help the wounded, another left in pursuit of the partisans, who had not been content simply to derail the train, but had opened fire as our men struggled to get free of the wreckage. Officers were blowing their whistles, and at least 3,000 men from our train climbed down. We were divided into three groups. The largest of these, about 2,000 strong, was sent out in pursuit of the enemy. I was included in this section. The second was sent to help the wounded comrades, while the third was deployed in the media area to ensure the protection of the train. The bulk of my belongings, like everyone else's, remained on the train, and at the blast of the whistle, we dog-trotted off into the countryside, which lay under a foot of snow. Running through snow is not easy. In less than 2 minutes, one is lathered with sweat, and after 20, it is almost impossible to breathe. Within an hour, one's lungs feel bruised to the pressure of one's ribs, and everything is dancing with colored lights. The weather wasn't very cold, and the effects of our gymnastic efforts nearly suffocated us. The non-coms and officers who had followed us eventually grew tired of sustaining a zealous performance and resumed a walking pace. An hour and a half after leaving the train, we slogged into a large peasant village, our heads drooping with fatigue. Almost all the houses had thatched roofs and attached sheds made of woven sunflower stalks for storing winter supplies. When we arrived, the place was already full of German soldiers, and the snow-covered central square was tightly packed with civilians, men, women, children, gesturingly, excitingly, and talking loudly. Soldiers, some of them with Spandaus ready to fire, were stationed all around the square, and toward the center, other soldiers were shoving their way through the mass of civilians, roughly driving some of them off to one side. To the right, beside a building, which probably served as a village hall, a third group of soldiers were standing with drawn guns over a dozen Russians lying on their stomach in the snow. At first, I thought they were dead. Partisans we caught here, explained one of the soldiers standing beside me. Were they really guilty, or were they only suspects? None of the questioning was up to me. The interrogations lasted for an hour. The Popovs lying on their stomachs must have had frozen guts, but that was true for our machine gunners, too. An SS section had been included in the pursuit group. I had the honor of being assigned to them by a smaller group of 100 men who, like me, were returning to duty. Their attention was undoubtedly drawn to me by the edge of my left sleeve with its gross Deutschland inscription. The SS preferred to use men belonging to elite divisions. Without explanation, we were loaded onto SS trucks, ignorant of the fate of the civilians lying on the ground. We drove for about 20 minutes over a very hilly country. Then we were ordered to leave the truck. An SS Hauptmann in a long, dark leather coat addressed us briefly. You will fan out to the right and move into those woods, taking every precaution. A factory which you can't see from here is situated about 3/4 mile to the west. The Russian informants who are accompanying us have indicated this is an important center of terrorist operations. We must take them by surprise and wipe them out. He appointed squad leaders and we moved off. What a splendid convalescence. I would have done better to stay in the hospital in Vinnytsia. After a short time, we saw a series of metal roofs, which must have been part of the factory. But before we had a chance to give them a second look, a burst of machine gun fire broke the silence. One of the SS men shouted, "We've got you, you bastard! You might as well give up!" It looked as though the Russian partisans we'd caught in the village had given this place away under pressure. There were some more shots, and then the familiar clatter of Russian machine guns coming from the edge of the building. Another fellow and I threw ourselves down under a small tree whose snow-laden branches touched the ground. We heard whistles ordering us to advance, but for the moment I stayed where I was. It would be too stupid to get knocked off by a handful of terrorists. The other fellow muttered in my ear, "The bastards, we really gotta get them this time. Now we'll teach them to blow up trains." After 5 minutes of hard fighting, German soldiers began to stand up all around us. We had taken about 10 more Russian prisoners. Some were singing a Russian song of vengeance, but most were begging for mercy. About 30 SS men were herding them toward the truck, beating them, shouting questions. We thought everything was over when the SS captain blew his whistle to fall in. "Those bastards," he said, gesturing at the sobbing prisoners, "claim they're the only ones here. Maybe they think they can fool us and protect their friends who are still hiding inside. But I want you to clear this place." He pointed at the factory building. "We've got to take the whole bunch, and all the weapons are hiding there." Of course, there was no question of argument. With dry mouths, we moved forward into the factory building, which were littered with hundreds of large objects. Ideal for snipers and as bad as possible for us, the relatively large size of our force was in no way reassuring. Even if we overwhelmed the partisans in the end, each bullet they fired was bound to hit someone. And if I should happen to be the only casualty in a victorious army of 1 million men, the victory would be without interest for me. The percentage of corpse in which generals sometimes take pride doesn't alter the fate of the men who've been killed. The only leader I know of who finally made a sensible remark on this point, Adolf Hitler, once said to his troops, even a victorious army must count its victims. What was made in this factory lost in the wilderness? Perhaps they processed timber? The first shed housed a large bandsaw, and farther on we passed several others, as well as a kind of dredging machine with a string of rusty scoops. The first two sheds were empty. Perhaps the prisoners have been telling the truth, but our orders were to check the whole place. Our group surrounded the entire factory complex and then began to move toward the center. We passed through a series of enormous barn-like buildings which seemed to be on the point of collapse. They had never been painted, and every iron fixture was half eaten away by rust, like the old anchor chains at a port. The wind was blowing hard, and the buildings echoed with sinister creaking sounds. Otherwise, everything was quiet, except for an occasional clatter made by one of our men deliberately shoving aside some metal object or overturning a pile of crates. About eight of us had moved into the darkness of a building littered with a jumble of miscellaneous clutter. There are no windows, and consequently there was no light. Then we all heard a series of clicking sounds. But the wind blowing through the building filled the air with the bangings and clickings of loose boards and tiles. Although everyone understood that theoretically each moment might be our last, no one really accepted that idea, and no one took any special precautions. Outside, the SS must have cornered several Russians. We heard a series of shots and cries, and sounds of running and shouting. Suddenly, our shed was filled with the noise of explosions. Five or six flares thrown from a room or closet in an upper story lit the darkness, and almost simultaneously, four of our companions screamed with pain. A moment later, two of them collapsed on the dusty floor, while the other two staggered toward the open door. The rest of us looked hastily for shelter, stumbling through the darkness, uncertain of where we might find cover. There were several more shots, and somewhere to my right, two more soldiers howled with pain. My gun shuddered violently in my hands. A bullet had struck it in the butt, taking a piece with it and missing me by inches. The two fellows trying to get to the door were hit again, but neither of them fell until they reached a drift of white snow which the wind had blown over the threshold. Outside, more soldiers had run up, but they stopped at the door and fired a few shots which were far more likely to hit one of us than any partisan. There were two of us still unhurt, and we began to shout as if we were 50. Some idiot might think of tossing in a grenade, which would finish us along with all the Russians. Luckily, someone heard us in time to think of another tactic. While our comrades outside tried to break through the corrugated iron walls, the Russians inside were firing at every detectable movement. The bullets which pierced the flimsy wall were as dangerous to our men outside as to us. I was half dead with fright. Was I going to be the last German soldier left in that damn shack? I knew that at least one other comrade was hiding somewhere. I felt even more caught in a vice of terror and danger than I had at Belgrade. I bit my lips to keep from screaming. Our men outside were pressing in and about to blow the building apart, while inside the Russians were perched in the rafters as silent as spiders. From where I lay, I could see nothing. Suddenly, I heard a scratching noise behind me, somewhere between a haphazard pile of object and an upright support. I froze as still as the large glazed pipe behind which I was hiding. The uproar outside prevented me from distinguishing anything clearly. I tried deliberately to extend my hearing beyond the limit of its capacity and caught a series of scratching sounds. Some very faint, some a little louder. I held my breath until my lungs were on the point of bursting and tried to stop the pounding of my heart. My brain was teeming with horrible possibilities. I saw myself dead, or a prisoner of the partisan, who'd used me in an attempt to escape from our noose. I was overwhelmed with an intensity of panic greater than anything I had ever felt before, which was suddenly replaced by a savage passion of self-preservation. Trembling with terror and rage, I abruptly stopped thinking. Some supplementary sense informed me that danger had drawn very close. Had I been a millionaire, I would have staked my entire fortune on the certainty that someone was moving on the other side of the barrier which concealed me. I felt very alone and desperate and determined to defend myself at any price. Suddenly I saw a man no more than 5 yards from me. I felt my skin crawl. Then a second man appeared behind him, crawling toward a pile of sacks. Although they had been in shadow, I had seen enough to recognize civilian clothes. The one nearest me was wearing a large cap. His silhouette remains indelibly stamped in my memory. He was tall and looked strong. He froze for a moment and appeared to be inspecting the shadows. Then he moved a few steps away from me. As slowly and silently as sand running through an hourglass, I raised my gun until it was pointing at him. I knew that there was still one bullet left in the barrel, so I didn't have to move the bolt. Tightening every nerve, I tried to suppress the trembling, which made my gestures uncertain. I knew that at the slightest sound, the other fellow would let me have it. Luckily, there was plenty of noise outside, which divided his attention. My gun was now level now, and my finger lay nervously against the trigger. Then I hesitated for a moment. It isn't easy to kill a man in cold blood, unless one is entirely heartless, or as I was, numb with fear. The man changed his course a little, and began to move slowly toward my hiding place. His companion was scarcely visible now and must have been 20 yards from us. I could hear the man breathing as he approached. For a moment, perhaps, he distinguished a figure crouching in the shadows or glimpsed a dull metallic gleam. For a tenth of a second, perhaps he hesitated. Then a sudden glow of brilliant light blinded him and he collapsed in the dust, his belly torn open by the shot fired from the weapon which still quivered in my sweat-drenched hands. The other Russian had run off, leaving the companion dead at my feet. I felt as if my skull enclosed a black void and then a nightmare enclosed me like a fever. As the noise outside grew louder, I felt myself sinking into a pit of unimaginable depth. I was torn between the desire to flee and my paralyzing fear. I stared at the corpse lying face down on the ground in front of me. I couldn't really believe I had killed him and waited for the tide of blood, which would soon begin to seep from his body. Nothing else mattered to me. The weight of the drama had just occurred was so overwhelming that I could only stare at the motionless body. Suddenly, a piece of the wall collapsed. The soldiers outside had managed to pull off a section of corrugated sheeting, and the glare of full daylight somehow diminished the importance of what had happened. The sight of other German soldiers enter the building snapped me from my lethargy. I even distinguished the SS captain who had just joined them, ducking down between a piece of crumbled metal. He was facing me at a distance of 20 yards. "Anyone still alive in here?" I waved a hand, and he saw me. I knew that there was at least one Russian in the building, and I didn't want to attract too much attention to myself. Another German, who must have been as terrified as I was, shouted from somewhere deeper in the ruins, "Over here, Kameraden. I've got a wounded man, too." "Don't move yet," the captain shouted back. "We're going to clear out the rest of the pop-offs." He'd spotted the dead man lying at my feet. We heard the sound of an engine which was rapidly growing louder. From my hiding place, I could see a black machine gun carrier rolling across the snow. A moment later, it was thrusting through the hole in the wall with an SMG pointing from its turret. A powerful headlight lit up the shed, and soldiers crouched behind the vehicle were aiming their guns at the interior. The beam of light passed over me and a shiver ran down my spine. I could almost imagine the faces of the waiting Russians contorted with terror. In the doorway, beside the two German bodies, I could see other German soldiers regrouping. The Hauptmann shouted, "Surrender, or we'll shoot you down like rats." There was no answer. Then a cry of terror rang out from the dimly lit rafters, like the cry I had fought back in myself a few moments before. The heavy machine gun began its slaughter. Each explosion echoed through the shed as if it would blow it apart. The bullets themselves were explosives and ripped open the roof, letting in new streams of daylight. All the German soldiers outside were firing into the rafters, where some 15 Russian terrorists were still hiding. I doubled over onto the floor and pressed my hands against my ears, trying to deaden the sound. Directly overhead, I could hear Russian machine guns. Once again, there were blood-curdling screams, and a body fell to the floor with the heavy thud of a quarter carcass thrown down on a butcher's block. The SMG demolished the rest of the roof, and full daylight flooded in, destroying the partisans' last hope of invisibility. Another fell to the floor as the rest began a frantic attempt to scramble away through the twisted metal supports overhead. Some dropped to the floor, others clung to the rafters. In the end, all were killed, and our deaths on the train were avenged. The place filled with German soldiers, and I was able to leave my hideout. I was covered with dust and even found a piece of debris between my belt and coat. We marched back to the village singing, "Markisch Heide, Markisch San, sind der Marsches Freud, sind mein Heimatland." We were still the masters, and no one under heaven could judge us. The SS took over a few of the prisoners who had surrendered before the massacre and loaded them into their trucks, which they drove off down the road that had been brought us here. We were ordered to fall in by threes. By the time we reached the village, the crowd that had watched us leave was gone, which was a relief. The SS task force gave each of us a slip of paper to explain the delay in our return to our units. We were advised to rejoin the wrecked train immediately. No one regretted leaving that place with its miserable memories. Unfortunately, a final spectacle, as depressing as anything we'd seen in the shed, was unfolding just as we marched by. A firing squad was performing its duties. Four consecutive salvos rang out, each one disposing of four partisans. Their bodies were left in the snow, and the squad marched back to the village. Not one of us said a word. At least 100 of our soldiers had been summarily killed in the derailment and the disintegration of some of the cars. An officer spoke to us briefly about the tragedy he just witnessed. Partisans were held responsible for everything that had happened. Also, partisans were not eligible for the consideration due to a man in uniform. The laws of war condemned them to death automatically without trial. We spent the night on the motionless train. I was able to sleep only fitfully and with difficulty. Each time I closed my eyes, I was caught in a hideous nightmare. A huge stone rose up in front of me. From beneath it, a flood of dark, blackish blood flowed toward my feet, burning them as it touched.